building?
You want me to go round everybody up?
I think you just did. I said, I think you already did.
I thought he meant to go get more people to fill the church out.
I mean, I could do that too, but.
I got Thomas coming in.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you again for all your blessings. Thank you for the opportunity you've given us to come out to your house to worship you, spirit and truth. Thank you, Lord, for those that came for Sunday school this morning. We thank you, Lord, for a good lesson we had. And I pray now, Lord, that the Spirit of God might carry us on through the 11 o'clock hour, that the will of God might be done, that he'll be given glory, honor, and praise for everything he's done. We ask, Lord, for salvation for those that's not saved. I pray that the word of God might lodge in their hearts, that they might choose this day to turn from sin and receive Christ into their hearts before it's too late. Now, Father, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. 44.
Thank you.
Got you this time.
All right. Got a couple checks in the mail, one from Brenda, one from Donna, and we appreciate their offering, and they always watch us on Facebook when they're not able to come. All right, Brother Wayne, if you would, ask God's blessing.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning just thanking you once again for allowing us to be able to come to your church and hear your word, Lord. We just love you. And we thank you for everything that you have done for us and will do for us, dear God. We just ask now that you be with the pastor as he brings your word this morning, that his word will not fall on deaf ears. Thank you for all the ones that have come out to enjoy this blessing this morning, and all the ones that are watching on the video. May you bless them also. Lord, we just ask now that you would bless this offering, bless the ones that can give and the ones that can't. Be with us, God. Keep us all safe within your arms. And all these things we ask in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to have each one of you out with us this morning.
Come with me.
Do you have any prayer requests? Go ahead.
I have several. I don't know if y'all know, I don't know if he's told you, but Dad's going out of town next Wednesday. He'll be gone maybe, what, two and a half, 3 weeks?
Yeah.
And just keep him in your prayers as he's going and when he's coming back and when he gets there. Just pray that God keeps him safe and gives him a safe trip up there. Okay. And then another one I have is for my friend Doug. He's, I've said it before, but he's working DoorDash. He just found out that his car is on its last leg. He's got coolant and oil starting to mix. And he's not having much luck with DoorDash, so he's in a tight spot right now. And he doesn't have a second car that his family owns that he can drive. So, I have a praise also. Not in the hospital, don't have to have surgery yet. I don't know how long it'll be before my next one, but okay. Just appreciating the freedom and everything.
All right.
And the bathroom and everything.
All right. Anybody else?
I got two. Okay. Belinda's mama's got to have a pacemaker. Something done with the pacemaker. I don't know if she's having another one put in or what, but she's having that done tomorrow.
That's what she said is going to be replaced, what Belinda said.
Okay. All right, remember that.
And one of James's coaches at Crockett, assistant coach at Crockett's grandmother, Sue Hensley, needs prayer too. I don't know the whole story behind it, that she was having back pains and stuff. And I got her name and told my girl. Put her on our prayer list.
All right. We'll do that. Anybody else?
Pray for my Papa Ward. He's about to pass on. He's just barely hanging on there. They're giving him morphine and stuff. So just pray for my family.
Remember that.
Keep remembering. I think y'all mentioned it about John having a motorcycle wreck last week. Keep remembering him. He's home. He
went
home the next day. He's having real bad headaches and stuff. And I remember his name is John Jones. And then his girlfriend Lisa, she has medical problems too. Remember her.
All right.
I have two friends that are not believers and they're not saved. I'm not going to say their names, but just pray.
All right.
Somebody, because I've tried to witness to them several times and they don't want to hear it from me, so.
Remember those?
Keep me and my family in your prayers. Get Rick and Jaden, they're putting their parts on the racetrack. And keep Kobe, the boy that I had prayer for last weekend. It's going to be the hardest thing for his dad and him. The decision is up to them done quick.
Okay. Remember that. Anybody else?
Please keep praying for Stephanie, Josh's wife's mother. I don't know. From the last I heard, she's somewhat stable. And if I'm wrong, Dad, correct me. But as far as I know, she's stable. They say that she might be able to go home.
Yeah.
So.
Just sort of iffy.
Yeah, they don't. It's just kind of up in the air right now. So just keep. I don't know if I should say her name. I don't know.
Right.
Jody.
Okay.
Yes. All right, remember that?
Remember a pastor and Ellen and Stacy with their back problems?
Okay.
I've been there. Fortunately, you know, thank God I don't have any more. But, you know, just.
I think you gave it to me.
Just be praying for them.
Okay.
Let God take care of us.
Right.
Pray for,
anybody?
Sorry.
Oh, it's good.
Pray for me and my family, and last week I meant to ask for prayer, and it slipped my mind for a friend of ours, Terry Rogers' mom was at the time getting ready to pass away, well, she did pass away, so pray for their family, because it's hard on people when they have to go through that.
Yep. Anybody else? Always remember the church, and remember Lexi. She's getting prepared for her start of the new school year. She's got a lot going on, trying to get her classroom ready and things like that. And remember Malia. She hasn't been feeling good all week long. Had it been pretty much. The past few days have been pretty rough. Her teeth and stuff, but. Remember her. I remember them. They're going to be coming in next weekend. So when they're traveling, and we get to see them for the weekend next weekend. So remember them. Any birthdays since last week?
Today's
Wayland's birthday.
Today? Oh. So up here and we'll sing happy birthday to you, buddy.
Over here.
Come over here on this side. There you go. All right. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. May each day of the year, may you find Jesus near. A happy birthday to you. A happy birthday to you. And the best one you've ever had.
Don't forget tonight at 6 o'clock, services, Wednesday nights at 7 on Facebook Live, and then on Saturday nights at 7 o'clock for prayer time. All right, here's Brother John.
Thanks, Ken.
He must be pretty old. Funeral homes more lively than what we are this morning. That's bad, isn't it?
Hallelujah.
That's good.
That's right.
You know, I appreciate you being here, and I don't know, we got several out this morning, and we got several more that needs to be invited to come out, right?
Amen.
Like Brother Chris said, sometimes people don't want to hear it, but you got to keep saying it.
Right.
You got to keep saying it. And everything, and I enjoyed church myself. My article was about church. If you've had time to read the newsletter yet, about how much you love the church, what you're willing to do for it, how much you want to sacrifice for it, how much you want to work. And, you know, we don't work for salvation, but we work out our own salvation after that we're saved. We're supposed to. Because one day here comes the judge.
Yep.
We're going to stand before him. I like that poem especially well. I was reading Facebook, and there was a poem by the famous author Wayne Parrish. Somebody may have heard of it. And I really liked it. And so I, instead of taking one on his list to use, I used it. So, and I can do that. I'm the editor. Amen. And so anyhow, we appreciate that. And I appreciate the fact that we're well aware that one of these days we're going to stand and give an account to God for them. Our actions and our inactions, both of them. So he's hitting us coming and going, But he hadn't and is not doing it without warning. He's told us it's going to happen.
That's right.
Yep.
And the decisions and choices that we make in this life, in this present time, will determine how we fare when we stand before the great judge, the Lord Jesus Christ.
That's right.
We're going to be in the book of John, chapter number 6 this morning. And we're going to be all over chapter 5 and chapter 6, but I'm not sure how we're going to do it. But if you would just open up your Bibles to John chapter number 6, we're going to begin reading at verse number 61. I bet I had some of you sweating. You thought I was going to read the whole chapter. 71 verses. All right. Bible tells us in verse number 61. I better turn back a page so I can get all of it. When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, "Doth this offend you? Does this offend you? What, and if you shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit. They are life. But there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. And he said it, therefore, said I unto you, that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father." Heard that in Sunday school this morning, didn't we? From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then Jesus said, Then said Jesus unto the 12, these are the select, these are the ones that he handpicked to follow him and to minister for him. He said unto them, "Will ye also go away?" Then Peter said, Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God." Father, we thank you. We praise you. And Lord, we ask your blessings. We ask, Lord, the anointing of the Spirit of God this morning upon the words that proceed from our mouth. I pray, Lord, that we'll be guided by the Spirit of God, that we might say only those things that would be pleasing unto you. I pray, Father, for that one that's cold and indifferent this morning, that the Spirit of God might build or rekindle that fire that's burning on amber. I pray, Father, this morning that that one that's not saved, that you'll build that fire of the Holy Spirit in that heart, that they might trust Jesus before it's too late. Now, Father, we ask for the word to be quickened and alive and meaningful to each one of us this morning. May it not go in one ear and out the other, but Lord, may the word of God this morning be lodged upon our hearts, that we might apply what you'd have us to do today in our lives. Father, I thank you, I praise you, I love you. Forgive us our sins, our shortcomings. We'll thank and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right. The title of the message this morning is, "Who are you going to call on?" Who are you going to call on? There was a movie on TV several years ago, and I guess still playing, about this town being infested with ghosts. And there was this group of scientists that got together and formed a task force. And they were called Ghostbusters. And they run advertisements on TV. If you're being hindered with ghosts, who are you going to call?
Ghostbusters.
That's right. And so listen, that's what the world is turned to today, is turned to the things of this world when they run into troubles and tribulations and afflictions. I say to you, when these things happen to you, who are you going to call on? Well, we're not calling the right people most of the time. We're looking in the wrong places, amen? And you're going to come up empty-handed because it takes professionals to minister to your needs. Amen? And I'm going to tell you, the professional that I'm talking about, there's only one. And his name is Jesus. He's our Lord and he's our Savior. And I appreciate him. And I pray that when we get done with this message today, and I say, who are you going to call upon? You're going to say, Jesus. Amen? Would you say Jesus for me real loud?
Jesus.
Say it. I mean, don't be ashamed. Say it loud.
Jesus.
You know, that puts the devil on the defense. When you're claiming Jesus as your help, as you're claiming Jesus as your Savior, the devil don't like it. Amen?
Right.
So I appreciate the name of Jesus. There's no other name given under heaven whereby we must be saved than the name of Jesus. There's no other name given under heaven that can minister to every need, every concern that you have. His name is Jesus today.
Right.
And I thank God for him. Amen. Every day you ought to get up saying, thank you, Lord, you gave us Jesus. He's my chief. He's my captain. He's my general. He's my all in all. Jesus is his name. Get it down in your heart and say it once in a while. Jesus is my help. Jesus is the one I'm going to in times of trouble. Jesus is the one I'm going to call upon. Amen. When I'm perplexed, when I'm troubled, when I'm going through depression, when I'm going through the valleys, Jesus is my help. He'll walk with you, Ellen. He'll hold your hand. He'll guide you through the most troublesome times in your life. And I'll guarantee you, you'll make it to the other side.
That's right.
If Jesus is your help, amen?
That's right.
All right, amen. That's a good message in itself. That's not my message, though. This is just kind of introduction. Well, if we look at chapter 6, it takes us back to chapter 5. It begins, if you look at the very first verse of chapter number 6, it says, after these things. Well, you got to go back to chapter 5 to find out what about these things. All right, in chapter 5, we see Jesus preaching salvation in his own name, in his own way, that he is the only means of salvation. And I've been preaching that for 38 years. Amen. That Jesus is the only way that you're going to make it to heaven. I don't care how good you are. I don't care how much you do in this world, good things. That's a credit to you, but it ain't going to get you to heaven. Jesus was preaching the word to these people that were legalistic in their doctrines, meaning to get to heaven, you have to keep the laws of God. You have to fulfill that law. And I got news for you. The law is not a salvation means. It is a means of pronouncing you guilty.
That's right.
Jesus is the pronouncement of salvation. And that's what he's preaching to them. And it offended them. He got them upset. Can you imagine that? Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and a heavy laden, I'll give you rest. He said, come to me and you'll have that salvation that you so desperately need. And it offended them. I find today that there's more people in this culture that we're living in today. We're living in an offense generation. You can't breathe unless it offends somebody. But I'm telling you, in the church, it's a shame that God's people gets offended when the man of God stands and lays out the word of God just like God gave to him. And it offends people. I don't have to take that, preacher. I don't have to take that hard word that's being preached today. I don't have to take it. You calling me a sinner. Listen, folks, it's not me that's calling you a sinner. It's the word of God.
Right.
And until we recognize that we are sinners, you'll never become a saint.
That's right.
You'll never be born again until you see a need of a Savior.
Right.
So chapter 5, Jesus is preaching salvation must be through him and him alone. And he was healing those that were sick with diseases. I mean, he was just going about doing good like he always did. And, you know, it offends some people sometimes. Well, why didn't he do something for me? Amen. Why didn't he do something for me? Well, may I turn the table? Why don't you do something for him?
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. I tell you, I really hate giving you the whole load, but you got it, and you're here today. You share this load with those that do not do anything for God, those that have turned their backs on him, those that have walked away. Jesus said to you and to me, will you two go away? Well, he's my help. After he went about healing the disease, after this we see that Jesus left Jerusalem. He crossed over the Sea of Galilee, and it brings us to chapter 6. All right, chapter 6. And a large crowd of disciples followed him over. I don't know how many it was. It says a large crowd. I'll tell you one thing, it was over 5,000 people with him. What a crowd following Jesus. And how many of this same crowd left him just shortly after? You see, a lot of that 5,000 crowd plus that followed him did not go and follow him because they believed Jesus. They followed him because of the miracles that they saw. And Jesus there preaching the word of God in chapter 6, and he was just laying it out there just like he's supposed to do. He's telling folks how to be saved, telling folks how to live right, being a light to the people. And lo and behold, don't you know, they were down in a place where there wasn't no food city, wasn't no food line out there, wasn't no Kroger's, wasn't any grocery stores around to buy any food. And you know what? Jesus had compassion on them. He said, they're hungry. Feed them. Well, we don't have anything here. All this here is the little boy's got 5 barley loaves of bread and 2 small fishes. What are they so many among so many people? I can just see Jesus say, shut up and tell them to sit down.
Amen.
Bring me that 2 fish and that 5 loaves of bread. And he dispersed them and he fed them. And you know what? The Bible says he took up 12 baskets of the fragments left over. I mean, how do you take 5 barley loaves and 2 fishes and get more after everybody's ate? It's a miracle.
Right.
Listen, we have a God today that's a miracle performing God. And he hasn't lost any power. He hasn't lost any of his ability today. You need a miracle? Who are you going to call on? Amen. We call on the specialist. I went to a specialist. Amen. A back. Orthopedics. Surgeon. Specialist. You know what? Jesus is a specialist today in any situation that you find yourself in. And so they went over, and Jesus used this message of feeding the 5,000, and he preached another word to them. Every miracle that Jesus ever performed was to get the attention of the people for the message he was about to deliver to them. And then he preached. a message to show that he is the bread of life. Chapter number 6, verse number 35. He said, I'm the bread of life. You've got to eat of the bread that I give. I am that bread that gives life. John 6:35, Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. And he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Amen? This offended them. Carl, can you believe that? Him saying, I am the bread of life, that you must eat of that bread in order to have life, and that you never thirst again. This offended them because it went against what they have been taught all of their lives. They have been taught all of their lives the laws of Moses, and that's good. The laws of Moses is good. But my friend, there is no salvation. There is no bread of life in the laws. The laws was a schoolmaster that was to teach and show us the need of a Savior, which was manifested in Jesus Christ. And this offended them. And you know what happened to them? They said, Jesus, we ain't got to listen to this. Like so many church members today, when a message is preached that pricks their hearts, they go to the things of the world.
That's right.
They flee the help that God is offering, the bread of life.
That's
amen?
Right.
I hope you won't be like that. I hope that you're going to be Christian enough to take the word of God with a grain of salt and savor the word of God. You know, salt just makes that flavor better. Amen? And also, salt will hurt a wound, won't it? But in the end, it heals that wound. All right. After this, many of his disciples murmured among themselves. They begin to talk about, you hear what that preacher, why he's just the son of Joseph down there. Who does he think he is? I'll tell you who he is. He's the son of the living God.
Amen.
He is the one and the only Jehovah God manifested in the flesh. That's who Jesus is. And they were offended and began to talk among themselves. Listen, we've had folks sitting right in our church talk among themselves and murmur about what's going on and the message and talk about Thomas and talk about Johnny and talk about Stacy and talk about the deacons and talk about one another murmuring. I thank God after your murmurings, you stayed with us. Amen. Right. Some didn't, did they penny? Some left, some fled. They were offended. Amen. Listen, I always say if you're offended, get over it.
That's right.
Get right with God and you won't be offended.
Right.
I love the word of God. I like it when the preacher and the man of God gets on my case. Because I know he loves me and he's trying to help me and he's trying to guide me in the right way. That's what Jesus was doing. They went back and they walked no more with him. And that brings us to Jesus' questions to the 12. Will you too go away? Our text verse, verse number 68. Simon Peter answered him the question. He answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. My question today is, who you going to call on? Who are you going to call on? Peter said, Lord, who can we go to? You've got all the answers. You've got the words of eternal life. You've got the direction you want us to go. Lord, you know what you're talking about. And that's the problem today. People are going to people that don't know what they're talking about.
That's right.
I read this morning in my little book that Carl gave me for Christmas by Jeremiah, Dr. Jeremiah. And Dr. Jeremiah was talking similar to some of these things. If you have that book, read it if you would. But My question is, where will you go? Who are you going to call on? So I got it down real fast last night. I got to bed early last night, if you believe it or not. I got to bed about 2:00. And that was kind of early for Saturday night. And God spoke to my heart on this message while we was at the camper yesterday, you know. And you sit there and you think about things. And Ellen and I went for a boat ride, and I was thinking about these things until Ellen got the seasick. The water was pretty rough, just tossing and turning real bad yesterday. Anyhow, we got there, the Lord began to deal with me on this. And last night, when I was sitting there doing the newsletter and all this, the Lord spoke to my heart. And Jamie, let me have that, mate. Thank you. So I got 4 things jotted down real fast I want to talk about. Number one, who are you going to call on? Who are you going to call on? I bet she's going to bring one at a time. Who are you going to call on for salvation? Did you know a lot of people today have called on the wrong means, the wrong system, have called on the wrong way of salvation. All right? John 6:35. We just read it. Let's look at it again. Jesus said, I'm the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. John 6:40 says, and this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. John 6:44 says, no man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. And John 6:65 says, therefore said I unto you that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. Now notice on this verse of scriptures, and you can go through the Bible, and there's tons more that points to Jesus is the only way. John 14:6, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and life. No man comes to the Father but me. But there's many scriptures that point that Jesus is the only way to salvation. Now, as we read these scriptures today, how many times did you hear me make reference to saying that good works would lead you to heaven? How many times did I tell you that man's knowledge and wisdom will point you the right way? How many times did I tell you that the church is the way for you to make it to heaven? 0. Right. You know why there was no references to these things, the good works, the man, and all these, the baptism? You know why? Because that is not God's plan of salvation. Right. But man today have called upon these for salvation. My question to you, who are you going to call on for salvation? In most cases that I see today, who did you call upon for salvation? Jesus. If you called upon any other way other than the name of Jesus, you are still in your sin, you're still on the road to hell, and you don't have a prayer without Jesus in your life.
Right.
These verses, along with John 5:39, says, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they that testify of me, they that testify of Jesus. Say it again. I like that name.
Jesus.
Come on. Don't be ashamed. Let the neighbors hear you say, Jesus, one more time. Amen.
Jesus.
I mean, that's good. I like that. I like that. Put cold chills on me. I hope you like it. Don't make you feel good just naming the name of Jesus today.
Amen.
And so, the scriptures are the means of salvation, but only the scriptures that testify of Jesus. Okay? Number 2, who are you going to call on for instructions? Jesus. Amen. With 2 Timothy 3:16, it says all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Instruction in righteousness. Brother Chris, you know what that means? That means the scriptures will tell you how to live right. The scriptures will tell you how, after you're saved, how to live a life that would be pleasing to Jesus.
That's right.
Listen, Jesus is the author of the instruction book.
That's right.
Think about that. I like that. Amen. It's Jesus that is laying out what it takes for you to live a Christian life. Who are you going to call on? We're going to call on the leftists today. We're going to call on those folks that don't believe the Bible today. We're going to call on those people that want to live any way they want to live. Amen? And we've been accused of that ourselves, you know, the independent fundamental Baptist believers. Once saved, always saved. Well, you believe you can live any way you want to go to heaven. Listen, that's a lie the devil manufactured years ago. We don't believe you can live any way. We believe you're saved. You won't want to live any other way than the way of Jesus. Amen? And we do not have a license to sin. And the Word of God will lead us. And the Word of God will lead us by that light that we heard about in Sunday school class this morning. It's a light that we can turn on or turn off. And so many people have turned the light of Jesus off and turned the light of the world on. And they're being led like sheep to a slaughter, unaware at the end of the road, the consequences of their actions. Amen?
Amen.
So, who are you going to call? If you stop following Jesus, who are you going to turn to? Who are you going to turn to for? Lord, what can I do now? You know, we sing songs that really have scriptural backgrounds, and we sing these songs. And Chris Salterson sang one time. I like it. It sang on "Why Me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of your blessings?" And I say today, why, Lord, give us the opportunity to come to you and ask for instructions on how to live my life. How many times have we been burdened with troubles of life? Who do you call upon? You call upon the one that's walked the walk, that's talked the talk. You call upon the one that wrote the instruction book, and he'll guide you. Amen? I mean, if I want to know how to do something, I read the instruction book. If I can get in touch with him and I have a question, it's the author of that book I want to go to. It's not people that's read the book before. Go to Jesus.
Amen.
Who are you going to call on when you need instructions? People today, Brother Thomas, have gone to the people of the world that is blinded to the truths of God's word. And I always keep in mind the scripture that says the blind lead the blind. They both will fall in the ditch. And if you follow man today, you're following his advice today, you're going to find yourself in a ditch. And don't look too hard. Your teacher's going to be in there with you.
That's right.
Amen. But Jesus is the one that we need to go to. Call upon Jesus. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the one that wrote the instruction book. Number three, who are you going to call on for comfort in distress? I'm going to make you a promise right now. You're going to go through valleys of distress in your life.
That's right.
You're going to go through valleys of persecutions in your life. You're going to go through some situations that you're going to say there's no hope for me. And I got news for you. If you call on the right one, there's hope.
Amen.
Jesus is my hope. He's my anchor. I tell you, he's my anchor in troubled water. Life is like a big old ocean. Sometimes it's smooth and calm, and sometimes it's rough. But Jesus is my anchor in times of trouble and in times of distress. Amen. Call upon him. He said, we sang the song this morning, didn't we? Come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Come unto me, all you that needs a touch of the Master's hand. Who are you going to call on in times of distress? Psalms 18:6 says, in my distress. Even the psalmist had distress, didn't he? Did you know something, Brother Wayne? Preachers had distress too. One of my biggest distresses is lack of attendance in our church. Lack of support for our church. Lack of love for our church. Lack of love for God in our lives. That's my distress. Amen. And some more of my distress, let me just throw it out there. Sometimes my distress is my lack of activity for God. Sometimes it's my lack of calling upon him that brings distress in my life. Sometimes we get so busy ministering to others, we neglect ourselves. Amen? I got news for you. You better take your vitamin, your spiritual vitamin pill every day, because you need the energy that's going to be expended for the glory of God. Amen? We are here to minister to one another. We are here to love one another. We are here to forgive one another. We are here not to bear burdens or grudges against one another. We are to be a Christian. And who are we going to call for when we're in that distress? Well, I'll call the preacher. Well, that's a pretty good starting point. He's going to point you to the one that can help you. He's going to tell you, we need to take it to God. I'm glad that you call upon me, that I can pray for you and point you to the right way. Amen. Who's the right way?
Jesus.
Ellen, I didn't hear you.
Jesus.
Amen. I heard of it. All right. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried unto my God. He heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry came before him, even into his ears. Today, people call on people that lets go in and out. The word that I just quoted, Psalms 18:6, said, and the Lord heard me. You know what? People hear you, but don't hear you. You know what I'm saying? They hear your words, but they don't hear your heart crying out. Our God hears your heart crying out in your distress. And if we know that he hears us, he will reach down and comfort us in our distress. Who are you going to call on in distress? It's coming. Amen. It's coming, isn't it? You've had it before. You know it's coming again. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. We're not sheltered from the afflictions and the pearls of this life. But we have somebody that will be our umbrella when this life rains down evil stuff upon you. Jesus is my umbrella. Amen. Call upon him in your distress, and he will deliver you from that distress. Number four, who are you going to call on for help in times of afflictions? Now, you might think afflictions and distress is the same thing. It's not. Distress is your feelings that you have, the emotions, the teardown. The affliction is things that causes this, distress. Affliction is things that happen in your life that causes distress. Well, who are you going to call on when afflictions come? They're going to come. Satan's out there on the job. He's throwing fiery darts all the time. And sometimes, I know you don't, but sometimes I let the shield of faith drop and a fiery dart of Satan penetrates me. Does anybody else ever get weary and the shield of faith comes down? Reminds me of a time that Moses went up on a mountain and Hur and Caleb went up and held his arms up because Moses got tired, and as his arms went down, Israel was losing the battle. And he had two friends to help him. You know, Brother Chris, sometimes we need somebody to help us hold that shield up. We need somebody that'll be with us and help us in times of afflictions. And I'm just going to tell you right now, man will fail you. The system will fail you. The government, Brother Carl, will let you down. But there's one that's a friend that will stick closer than a brother, that will deliver you from the afflictions that the evil one is going to be casting at you. And his name is?
Jesus.
His name is Jesus. Who are you going to call on in your afflictions? 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober. Be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Let me say this. He's walking about seeking whom he can impute afflictions. Who he can cast affliction in your life. He's a roaring lion. He's not afraid of you. Satan's not afraid of you. But I want you to know something. The Bible says, be strong. Be vigilant. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Fear not. Don't you be afraid of that old devil. As long as you call upon Jesus in times of affliction.
That's right.
Oh, I don't know the kind of affliction that's going to come upon our lives. But I know this. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world.
That's right.
Amen. If you don't look at Jesus for your help in time of need, then who are you? Who are you going to look to? Who are you looking to? Now listen. You can sit down and you can think about this message a little bit when you get home. And you see if you haven't been guilty of looking in the wrong places in times of trouble in your life. In times that you needed help. In times that you needed your arms lifted up. Look and see if you didn't first look elsewhere for your help. And I believe that every one of us will say, I'm guilty of looking in the wrong places for help in the past. And then I think we all need to get on our knees and say, Lord, help me not to look in the wrong places. But Lord, help me look to Jesus for my help. Who are you going to call on? I'm going to call on Jesus. Amen. He's got an open line that you can call upon him any time of the day or night. Amen. We're selective sometimes on calling our friends and loved ones for help when the hour is late. Listen, our God never sleeps nor never slumbers. He's always attentive to your cry for help. And for your cry of thanksgiving, and for your cry of praise. He's always open to penny. Amen.
Amen.
Well, man cannot help you. Government cannot do nothing. Nothing can deliver you from the affliction that we all must face, but Jesus, he is the only way. Let's close, you want to? I find that it's impossible to find help from day to day with what we will no doubt face, except our Lord. Let me read that again. I find that it is impossible to find help from day to day with what we will no doubt face, except Jesus, except our Lord. He's the only way of help.
Amen.
We must keep the faith. We keep the faith by reading the Word, studying the Word. Faith coming by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. Okay? Study, keep the faith. You've got to grow in faith. Don't be happy with where you're at. Get more faith. Grow. You grow faith by studying God's Word, by hearing God's Word, by reading God's Word, by sharing God's Word. Your faith multiplies. It grows. And pretty soon you're going to look back and say, you know, I feel ashamed I ever doubted what you doubted, because your faith has grown strong in the Lord. Keep the faith. Exercise our faith in what Jesus can and will do for those that will follow him and his commandments. So if not Jesus, who are you going to call upon? What better help have you found in this life, in this world, in this universe, greater than Jesus, that you're going to call on them instead of him? Think about it. Who are you going to call on? If you got ghosts, call Ghostbusters. If you got spiritual problems, call on Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Let's bow our heads. Every head bowed, every eye shut. Maybe God spoke to your heart. I've said what I feel God wanted us to say. And I hope that it's penetrated our hearts, and that we are going to stop taking the advice of man, taking the advice of the world system, and we're going to start looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Maybe God spoke to you this morning, and you've never been saved. You've never been born again. You say, preacher, I want you to pray for me. I'm not saved. Anyone here, any of you folks on Facebook, you've never with your mouth called and asked Jesus to save you, put it down in the comments and we'll be glad to call you back, text you, talk to you, come and see you, and show you the road to heaven according to the Word of God. Maybe God spoke to your heart today and you've been looking and you've been going back to the wrong places for help in your distress, in your times of afflictions. Maybe God spoke to your heart and he said, preacher, God has showed me some things this morning that will help guide me and give me instructions according to the Word. Anyone? Yes, I see that and that one and that one. There'll be another. God spoke to your heart. God laid something upon your heart you'd like for us to pray with you about. You don't have to confess to me. You just have to say, God's dealt with my heart. Pray for me. Anyone? You hear you say this morning, God's blessed you with a message. Pray for you. Pray. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Father, we thank you for the word this morning. We thank you for those that have come. I pray now the working of the Holy Spirit might bring conviction and convincing to us, that we all might be submissive to the will of God, that we might be obedient to your will. And Lord, just guide us as we go. Have your will in your way, and we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's all stand if you would.
Page 97. 97.
Thank you.
Appreciate each one of you being here. Listen, make every effort can to be back tonight.
Uh-oh.
We've got to get people that love the church and love God enough to come back. Amen. We've got to have that. We've got to have people that fall in love with Jesus all over again.
That's right.
Brother Carl.
Let's pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for allowing us the privilege to come to your house to hear the word. Brother, I just pray that, Father, you'll bless Brother Johnny for the message he gave, that hopefully you'll touch somebody's heart that don't know you as their personal Savior, Father. We just pray that you watch out for us today as we go through our travel, that you give us safe travel and just watch over us, Father, and make us go in the direction you want us to go. Father, we love you, we praise you, we want to please you, and I pray that you lead, guide, direct me in the way you'd like for me to go. In Jesus' sweet and precious name, amen.
Amen.